All right, everybody, welcome back to Blades in the Dark, The Gambit, hour number two. My name is Matt, that's Mike, that's Ian, that's Emily, and that's Anthony. And it's still crime time, baby, so let's get back into it. Ian, we're on a ship. Where are we?
We're on a boat. Yeah. No, it's a ship. It is a ship. It's bigger than a boat. You're on the collapsing... The warship called the Foghound.
I thought you were saying that the boat was called the Warship, and I'm like, that's super metal.
No, no, it's called the Foghound. They're pretty, the Foghounds themselves are pretty right. Egotistical, so they didn't name a boat after themselves.
It's their boat, so.
Yeah. So you're on the collapsing boat. Right now, the crew is separated. Weaver is trying to chase down the second mate, Goldie, with his ragtag band of foghounds as he tries to escape, and Weaver doesn't want that to happen. Lyric and Oscar are conversing with a pot full of rats, who was sent by Creesa.
Really, to converse with the rats.
Yeah, to squeak at us.
Yeah. As Creesa is trapped, I guess between a rock and a hard place, as the ship crumbles on one side and there is a locked door on the other. I think we all know Creesa's got some tricks up his sleeves that are not just rats. So
yeah, he's also got ooze up there.
Yeah, so maybe some slime and some a little bit of
you know,
EO.
Elbow grease.
Yeah,
greasy elbows. Ugh. For sure.
Yeah, exactly. All right, so yeah, as we cut in, we, you know, it cuts to Creesa trapped in the loading bay of the ship. Creesa, you can hear the explosions of the engine bay as it explodes on the other side of the ship. There's more groaning. The storage itself is crumbling very quickly, worryingly fast. Collapse of the ship as it's kind of coming into a V, so it's like the middle is moving up as the sides move down. These boxes over here where the loading bay was previously blocked have slightly adjusted their position. So whereas it was completely blocked off, now there are gaps in there. There's ways that could be used as an escape route, as well as the door right behind you that they use to load the items onto the ship. That one, however, is locked with a padlock.
Could you ping that door real quick for the viewers?
Yes.
Cool, thanks.
It is the upper door. What does Creesa do?
What do I hear or see from where I am?
You hear a couple yells as the remaining foghound on the lower deck and the bandits were frightened. They actually left before before Goldie escaped up on the upper deck. Since the bandits are unreliable, they just kind of took off. They have kind of escaped the boat before the rest of their crew. The Foghound met up with these guys over here that are near the gangplank. Those foghounds didn't do anything to your bandits. The bandits are safe. You hear a yell as Bear's spirit dissolves into the air, and still the groaning of the ship as it collapses. And maybe some rats squeaking. Not your rats, but other rats that are on the ship.
All the rats are crazy.
Well, they're
rats
now.
Yeah.
Yes. You can control them. He's like Snow White, you know.
I'm saying you're hearing other rats that didn't come to your call at first as they try to escape the ship as it sinks, you know, as rats are off to do.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. No, well, I mean, the rats that I brought with me.
Yes, yes.
Okay, just wanted to make that clear.
Your rats are in a pot on the other side of the ship where
Eric
and Oscar.
They're on their own boat.
Creesa is still sitting on this box. You know, he looks at his watch, which I imagine is like far up his arm for no reason.
Hmm.
He looks at his little whistle and gives a little toot. Silent toot. You see that, you know, one last rat peek its head over the box. Grease says, like, where are they?
It squeaks a little bit back at you.
It probably shrugs.
Yeah. He's like, ah, get on. Get.
So he jumps off the box and does a belly flop into the water and, like, doggy, like, rat paddles, I guess, away.
I think it's probably about this point that Krisa hears, at least Oscar, probably Lyric too, but I don't know. Because everyone else, like, all the assailants have left the area, right? Like, they're all, like, fleeing. And
yes, currently the only enemy is the ship itself.
Right. And so Oscar, like, he can't figure out where Krisa is. He can't figure out how to get to him. His head's still all messed up. And, like, there's a pot of rats, and he knows that Krisa has something to do with that, but he has no idea how to communicate with rats. So he just starts yelling, and he's like,
Krisa, you gobsite, where are you? Krisa! You rat Krisa. Bastard! That's not a pun!
Krisa, you know, obviously hears all of that, and attunes to the ghost field and uses his ghost veil ability to walk through the wall back towards where the voice is coming from.
Secretly, Krisa right. was a whisper the whole time.
Nice. At least one of us gets to ghost veil.
Right? Well, I don't have it, so.
You know, probably, what, two stress, one to make it, you know, well, three total, one to do it.
It'd be one yeah. to do it.
One to make it go through staff and one to last like longer than
a Yeah, because to get moment. To them, you have to go completely ghost through all these walls and stuff. Yeah.
So that's three stress, and he'll walk straight through. Like, he goes right through the crew quarters, you know, arms, like, hands on his hips, and, like, walks through the wall that's opposite the crew. The
yeah, like, debris crew. Falling on you, but falling through you as it, like, doesn't touch you.
He, like, walks through, like, the hands up in there. What?
Like, Oscar, like, jumps because he hears that suddenly right next to him. And he's like,
what the fuck, Krisa? Where are you?
Didn't you get my rats?
Yes, of course I got the fucking rats, but they don't speak English.
They sure had something to say, but nothing we could fucking decode.
Listen, we can sort this out later. We've got to get off the ship. Do you know where Weaver is? He was fighting some arsehole, but then he's gone.
Krisa, like leans over to the pot of rats, smells him. I think he's back that way.
Which way is he pointing?
Like, just up behind him.
is that like the ship? Is that like up?
Which is like
top
this
where he
way.
Is?
Yeah.
Okay. He says
it's like down the corridor over where that, you know, ladder is over here, you know, leading that way.
He says, all right, then, my pants are wet and the bottom of my jacket as well, but I'd like to not get my noggin wet. Let's get moving.
And then like, he like gets up and he's like, you know, I meant that it's from the water. I haven't pissed myself, you know. I just want to make that fucking clear.
So like takes his pot of rats out the door.
Yeah, one of the rats like squeaks very shrilly, like as if he'd be surprised at that for some reason.
He just like looks around. He's like, "I just wanted to make it clear."
We appreciate that.
You're welcome. I suppose I'd be pissing straight in the anyway.
He's like trying to justify it. Like, it's kind of like peeing in the pool, except it's kind of the pool at sea, but we're in a ship.
And Lyric just pats him on the shoulder and just like, "You're not right in the head, buddy."
Okay. I got hit right in the head. Let's get moving.
So you you guys are trying to make are you trying to make your way back to where the ladder where Goldie and Weaver went up?
Someone
make
else
our
has
way
to try to choose. I don't know.
Off the ship.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. So what you would be doing is let me go to my thing right here. You would be walking down this corridor and taking a right up to this ladder over right about here. I mean, the boxes are blocking the way, and then behind them, the ship is like just falling apart, so it's completely pointless to go that way. But this other way is pretty much clear. If you go now, it's still, you know, it's not been totally reached yet by the collapse.
We're not collapsed.
Yeah, I mean, as soon as one of these guys finds, like, figures that out, I'm following them. Oscar has no sense of direction right now, so.
I imagine that this would be the point where Lyric finally kind of gets her bearings, you know, and she looks out, kind of eyes darting around, trying to adjust to the exploding scenery, and she's like, "Come on, guys, this way," and just like takes and she actually she grabs Oscar and kind of like takes him in her arm because she's pretty buff and Oscar's pretty small. So
it's true.
So she's just gonna scoop you up and then Krisa can come with us and his rats. But yeah, I'd say at this point Lyric takes charge.
All right. So you make your way up to the upper deck. You know, ship's falling apart. Water is now probably at 2.5 feet. So your pants are quite wet, all but, like, I mean, Oscar's is still more wet than others, God but, damn it. You know. I was saying because you're short. Gosh.
Thank you.
So you reach the top upper deck where you see, and if I can, I can't control Goldie. Why the?
He's his own man.
We're going to have to...
Have a talk, mister.
There we go. I still can't control him. Oh my gosh. Anyways.
You have the right tool selected, right?
Yes, I have the right tool. Move. Yes. I can move everyone, but what the...
Can you move Goldie's name? You could just use his name.
Sure. Goldie is over here. Okay. Let me delete the stupid thing while I try to fight off a sneeze.
Don't do it. Don't do it. Nice. No! Ah, so close. Hey, successful mute, though. Good job.
Yeah. So...
Game on point.
Yeah. This time it muted. Didn't say this. Yeah. Weaver, you're over here now, as Goldie and his crew tries to... They're attempting to go in the gangplank, and as you guys crawl out this, this hole, you can... see him trying to do whatever he's doing. I mean, Mike,
Sorry, what is Weaver doing? Or him being Goldie?
Weaver, yeah. Okay. You can't see the crew you can't see the foghounds, but you can see Weaver looking at them. So Weaver, what are you doing? Like, what are you trying to do right now?
Okay, so there's Goldie, and there's four foghounds.
Yeah.
Okay. Weaver can't win that fight. and I think that even in his current state, he's smart enough to realize that.
I'm pretty sure the person of the crew that would be capable would be Silas, and I'm not even sure then he would still be able to
do that. Weaver was, like, running after them, but they're, like, trying to get on the gangplank, and I think Weaver just stops, just, like, about where you have him, and just, like, watches them leave.
Yeah.
With just glaring at them, just... gripping his weapons super tight.
Yeah. And they leave. Goldie gives you one last look. And it's not like hate. Obviously he's watched members of his crew, which was his family, die, you know. His leader and his, you know, the other joint leader, I guess. So he gives you guys one last look. Very defeated look, Weaver. So while you have not killed him, you have, in essence, you guys have defeated him.
If there's even a moment wherein Goldie looks at Oscar, Oscar spits on the ground or the deck at him.
In the water?
Well, we're on the upper deck, so.
Yeah. You can still spit in the water. You can still spit somewhere, but.
I'm spitting on his damn ship.
Okay. Ooh. There's a look of defiance as he walks away, but he doesn't do anything.
He ain't defying shit.
Yeah, so I think that...
GM smirks.
With that, I am guessing that everyone is together now. We're all like...
We're all on the ship.
Okay.
Reunited, so, and it feels so good.
Without... necessarily looking at anyone, I realize that they're there, but without looking at them, hands down at my side, holding my weapons, like, white knuckle. I just very matter-of-factly just say, let's go.
And as you're doing this, you hear, Weaver, you hear that familiar laughing, like it's very far off, but a very mocking laugh, like, to, like, kind of pouring salt on the wound.
The laugh goes, kappa, 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 kappa.
Yeah, so, I mean, do you do anything else, or do you leave the ship?
So I think we leave the ship, but, like, as Weaver says that, he says, Weaver, we've still got work to do. You're the one who knows where the fence is. It's about time we pay him a visit, don't you think? Or should we let this simmer for a few days? That gives up an opportunity for someone else to come in and swoop up a prize.
As you say this, and you've exited the ship, the kind of room up here on the ship, at the top of the ship, explodes.
Oscar pays no mind. He's just like, that's not what we came here for. Like,
dock hands are starting to gather on the docks to see this ship as it's going down, because it's kind of sizable, and it's very quiet.
No, definitely not.
I think that we should probably put some distance between us and this immediate area before probably the entirety of the Blue Coat forces arrive to see what's going on.
Aye, and the Spirit Wardens.
Mm-hmm.
Spirit Wardens.
Speaking of which, you see the crows that are they're already coming.
I see them.
There's crows circling up in the sky, but they're like...
actual crows.
You know, and you actually see like the body of Winston float out of like a portion of the ship, like, and a couple of the other members, like maybe a foghound or two face up in the water. The ship's exploding, and like the crows don't move in because the fire is too intense, and they're just kind of circling at this moment.
Is there any way to reach Winston's body without getting in the water?
I mean, no. He is hundreds and hundreds of feet away in the water, like, floating face up.
Sure.
And I imagine that as we're walking away, Lyric hears this, this is only heard by her, the screaming and howling, kind of like, you know, the screams of the damned. And basically it's like the being in the proximity of this wrecked ship and these dead bodies, you know, is not only taking her back to her past traumatic event, but also to the need she has to feed, like, the spirits in the Void Sea per her ritual. And since she hasn't satisfied that yet, like, she can kind of just, she can hear this awful shrieking, and she's, like, wincing and kind of gripping onto Oscar, and maybe he'd be right. Like,
well, yeah, and it might even be down.
Like you're holding Oscar's hand,
and it might even really... be like the
sorry, go ahead.
No, you go ahead. Okay, I'll say
yeah, you're holding Oscar's hand like really, really tight, and Oscar like reaches his hand up on your shoulder and says, Lyric, it's time to go.
And she just shakes her head and she's like, you don't understand, but you will.
You're right, I don't understand. I do understand that it's time for us to go, unless we want more complications, though. We can talk more about this later.
Yeah, and she just kind of nods and resigns herself, just trying to shake it out of her head. But, yeah.
What is Krisa doing as this goes down? Like,
he's talking to his rats, like...
Yeah, exactly.
He's, okay. He's holding a pot of rats, and he's... He was pretty calm, but then they started talking about the Blue Coats and the Spirit Wardens, and now he's looking kind of shifty.
Yeah.
He's pretty uncomfortable with that.
Yeah, and I think, Krisa, as you're kind of like becoming a little more shifty and paranoid, you see actually two Blue Coats down the street as they turn a corner to like look and see what's going on. Like, they don't run. Like, these Blue Coats, they're not paid enough to go check out what explosions are in case they die. But they're watching from a distance, and they kind of notice
holding his pot higher to like kind of hide behind.
Do I see them? Do I see the Blue Coats?
Yes. And they, all the blue coats see is a man holding a pot of rats in front of his face, and they start to get interested.
I see the blue coats, and yes. I say, it's really time to go. Let's go.
All of you see the blue coats.
We better snipe. Let's get scooting along.
All right.
Tell you what, and like as we're walking away, Oscar says, it'd be best if we split up for a few weeks. Maybe it took some time for ourselves, but this Friday, which we'll just say is like 3 days from now, come to the Gambit, and we'll have a meeting.
I think that Weaver, he just nods and just takes off in a direction.
Cool. Creasa like squints and looks at him. Why'd you call the blue coats?
It looks at me.
Yeah.
Creasa, what are you talking about?
Why are there blue coats?
Well, because they're, for all their weaknesses, they're the police force here. What? Are you not from around here? Is there something?
Where's my coin? Do you have my coin?
Creasa, you know we don't have the coin yet. We're working for it.
This is going on the tab. First, I break the ship.
Yeah, that you did.
And then we almost died.
Well, I think that point number one and two are a bit correlated, don't you think?
You didn't listen to my rats.
Creasa,
we tried.
You're right,
we
I didn't.
We can't attune to your rats.
Very simple instructions. He like pours the pot of rats out, and they you know like plop onto the docks or whatever. Like,
and as you say this, two more blue coats like pop out from behind the other two, and like one of them appears to be the superior, and he pats the other ones on the head, like, "What are you doing? Get to work."
He says,
they all start to move towards you.
Creasa, until later, I've got very simple instructions, which is that we should bug out of here and meet up in a couple of days at the Gambit. We've got to go. And he, like, kind of grabs Lyric by the arm and, like, starts walking the other
way. Creasa's, like, swatting the air with his pot. how far... I guess we're right there on the gangplank, right? And the boat's sinking behind us.
Yeah, I imagine we've walked a little bit in further onto the dock. Like,
right.
We're not standing right there on the edge, right? So.
Yeah.
Creasa puts the pot on his head and jumps into the void sea.
Oh!
Oscar just turns around.
Okay. And, I hope you're a good swimmer.
And just says, Eric, I think what's important right now is that we just keep walking. and trust that whatever he's up to, he's got a plan for it. Or he doesn't, and he's going to get lucky like he did today. Look, we should get going.
None of our concern.
Well,
let's beat it.
Perhaps that's the case.
All right. And scene as it cuts away. So let's deal with the after effects of this. So, a score yields a rep per tier of the target. You didn't keep it quiet. So get that rep.
You know, I could make an argument that we did.
Oh, get
I'm just
out
kidding.
Of here!
I'm totally kidding.
Five people escape and the ship explodes, and you kept it quiet.
Well, okay. Let's be real. This is 6 feet to start with.
Quieter.
Six feet to start with. You know, we all know that's the case. Wild and devastating. It has to be that.
So yeah, you guys get a rep. Yeah.
Boom.
One rep for the tier of the Foghounds, who are now no more.
Do we get an extra rep for obliterating another crew? Is that a thing?
Breaking all their stuff.
No.
Okay. Darn.
If I read the rules and find something, I'll update it later. But right now, it's just one rep.
Hey, we're only three away from
coin.
From advancing our tier.
Coin. I mean,
the only way that we really could get coin from this is because we're taking on that fence. Then whatever revenue he had that was going to go to the Falcons is now going to us, you know. So maybe it was a situation where, like, hey, I just sold off all these stuffs. And we're like, yeah, so that money's going to us now.
So that, that, and perhaps because the Foghounds are out of the picture as an organized group, more people are relying on, and there's been another nautical attack, more people are relying on the Strait as a means of smuggling their goods. So by proxy of our nature, we get more coin.
Let's say this is a major score because you killed off a crew. So that'll be 8 coin.
Nice.
The next one, so mark that down and you can distribute it between the crew and such, you know, when we get to there.
Sure. I think we're just doing even across, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's usually what we've done. Yeah. So yeah. 2 to each. Heat. How they were not necessarily high profile or well connected. It happened on hostile turf.
I do have a heat from that extra devil's bargain as
yes,
well.
Yes, yes, I remember that. I wrote that down, yeah.
I'll start adding these into the crew sheet.
Yeah. So add 1 heat for this, your devil's bargain.
I've done it.
Add 1 because it was on hostile turf.
Okay.
You were not necessarily at war at the time of the score. However, you would be now. So I'm not going to give you that one. You have enough at this point. we're going to add 2 because killing was involved.
Okay.
How many are you at now?
4.
4. It has to be 6 heat for the base level.
I don't necessarily know that it does.
Wild and devastating is a pretty accurate description
for yes, what just happened. Yes, but also the 4 one is loud and chaotic, which I feel fits this because for one they're only a tier 1 crew. If it was a bigger crew, it would be more in the news. They would have better sway. They weren't necessarily as big. Plus
it was
very like in this one area was there a lot of violence and explosions. So
it wasn't in an area that was like, it's not like we started a gang war in a public square and destroyed a building, right? Like
plus like yeah
for it, next time.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah. Plus, like, I would have to then say, is there any, that there's nothing that could get, it couldn't be any louder than this, which it could be, which would then be 6. So I'm going to say 4.
Okay.
I am a very gentle god who does it.
I am a third wanted god. Level. yeah, we're 1 heat away from that.
Yes.
That's cool. I like it.
Does this increase our hold? I don't know how hold works exactly.
Hold goes up when we level up if we choose to.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
And I believe you're at.
And we do get the claim of the luxury fence, right?
Right. 2.
You can mark that down.
Yeah. We can handle
it. At some point, you go back and you talk to him, and he is totally on par with it.
Saw what we did, so.
Yeah.
You probably didn't like those damn foghounds anyway. Always selling some part goods.
Didn't. Some of them weren't bad. Margit herself wasn't terrible to him, he says, but like the rest of them were pretty nasty. Entanglements.
Yeah.
Roll according to your level of heat plus your wanted level.
Which is 2 at the moment, yeah.
Yes.
So
rolling on the 6 scale because you're at 8 heat.
Much heat.
So roll. According to your level, plus your 1 level. See, yeah.
What are you rolling?
You're at heat. So somebody, if someone could give me a 2d6 roll. To decide the 2 that you're going to pick from because if you're slippery. All right.
I did it.
So the 2 you have are flipped. One of your contacts, patrons, clients, or a group of your customers switches allegiances due to the heat on you. They're loyal to another faction now. Or is it 3? Show of force. A faction with whom you have a negative status makes a play against your holdings. Give them 1 claim or go to war.
It would be a really big bummer for us to lose a claim immediately after doing the whole thing to get one. Yeah. And you I also think that it's entirely, well, I mean, and not to say that we couldn't do that, right? Like, that could very well be a thing that happens, but I think it would make a lot of sense, honestly, if, I don't know if by, was Cohart's on the list of people that would get pissed at us?
No.
Oh, okay.
Context.
Okay, because I was going to say that.
So that'd be someone like Dennis Berger or something like that. So I think that, the flipped makes sense.
Who's our contact that's leaving us, though?
Do you want me to pick?
Which
one? I mean, yeah, that's up to you.
Like, so on our crew sheet, the only contact we have is Rigney, the tavern owner who's working at the Gambit, but there's obviously more.
You also have all of the friends that you have.
Right, and Roth, the
however, I think there's a specific one that comes to mind now who might be leaving at this time.
Okay. Shall we take it?
If you want to take it, yeah.
What do you guys think?
Not.
I think it's a better choice than going to war with someone at the moment.
I agree.
Probably.
Close your shop face and all.
Yeah.
That's coming along pretty well, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, let's go ahead and let's do that. Let's go ahead and, all right, and have someone get pissed at us. But not in a war way.
Yeah. So what happens is, I think we'll cut back to, you said you were going to meet in a week or so.
Yeah, a few days.
At the Gambit.
We'd meet back up at the Gambit, yeah.
Okay, yeah, a few days. So I think 3 days later, there's been a lot of heat on the docks in the last couple of days trying to figure out what's going on. You know, they put out a few profiles. A man with a pot that held some type of animals was stated. They saw someone matching up Stripton swimming away, I believe, from the docks. It has the dock workers in a bit of a frenzy because it matches up with a local myth. So they're kind of out.
That's awesome.
They kind of know that you guys have done it, but there's not enough evidence to actually charge you with anything at this point.
And we're such a small gang, too, that it's almost like they did this? Like, come on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dennis Berger has been working his butt off, trying to talk to everyone and try and make it seem like he's actually done his job when he hasn't. So I think we're going to flash to the Gambit. Yeah. Flash to the Gambit. Go ahead.
Can I set the scene for what we're doing at the Gambit?
Sure.
So I think that... how many people are there? Right, like, is Krisa at the Gambit, or is he still swimming somewhere?
I don't think he comes to the meeting, does he?
Okay.
I don't know.
It's up to you.
What was Ian? I was going to say
that he does, based off of some stuff we've been talking about. I mean, it's up to you, Anthony. Do you come to the meeting?
I'll roll with that. Okay. Krisa's at the meeting.
So there's like six of us, right? There's the four of us, with Casis and two of the two remaining bandits. So
there's three.
There's bandits. Two, right? Because Weaver and Winston are separated from the original four.
Weaver was separated prior to this. Bird and Weaver were two of the named bandits that have not necessarily been part of them for a while.
Understood. Okay,
so a couple came on. So Winston was like one of the old hires. There's two new and then one old hire. So there's three other bandits left.
So Oscar, everyone's sitting around a table. And Oscar comes out with the exact amount of glasses plus one. And he sets them on the table and he spreads them out. It's just a shot glass. He puts one in front of everyone. And then there's one in front of an empty chair. There's also an empty chair that he hasn't sat at yet, but that's a different chair. And he pours a drink out to everyone and he says, lads, lass, we've had a rough couple of days and it's important that we keep our heads down. And when you leave here tonight, make sure to stagger your departure so we don't take any heat here. But it's a good thing what we've done. It may not feel like it right now, but it's a good thing. And as he's like saying this as he's pouring the drinks, and he walks over to Winston's and he starts pouring the drink and he says, "We lost one of our men, and you all know that, and it's a hard thing. I don't know how you all are handling it. Some of you seem more battle-hardened than the rest of us, or at least more than me, but I get to be the one to go talk to Helen, his wife, tomorrow, so be thinking about me about with that one as I go and do that. Anyway, I guess I don't know what else to say. I just wanted maybe to have some sort of toast. Krasa, you've done a good job. Everyone's done a good job. Really, we couldn't have made it here and done this whole thing without all of us working together. And I'm sure I'm just as sorry as anyone else that Winston's no longer working with us. So, drinks are on the house tonight. And, like I said, make sure to stagger your departure." And he, like, sits down and holds up the glass and takes the shot.
The bandits take the shot as well.
Krasa looks at his drink and leaves it on the table.
Damn, dude.
Weaver is, he's sitting, leaning back in his chair, and he has the glass in his hand, but it's still kind of like on the table, and he's just rolling it around. But he hasn't taken a drink yet. He's kind of just staring at the drink, just like rocking it back and forth in his hand. He looks like he hasn't slept at all in the past 3 days.
Where's he sitting at the table?
I'd imagine, like, he's not at the head, but at, like, the corner. If it's a rectangular table.
I was thinking it's a round corner. One, but...
I was thinking round, too.
Okay, that's fine. Then he's just at one of the corners of the square round table.
Okay. Is he next to the other bandits?
Yeah, I think he is. Okay. I think he's in between, like, whoever is to his right, and the rest of the bandits are to his left, and he's kind of like a divide between whoever's next to him and the rest of the bandits.
Sure, sure.
Does he take the shot?
No, I don't think he takes his drink right away.
Okay. Krasa, like, looks at him and, like, you know, sizes him up. He looks a little rough, right? Like,
Oh yeah, Weaver looks super rough.
He's had better days. Krasa says, "You smell terrible."
Does Lyric take the drink?
She already downed hers.
Okay. who smells terrible?
I think you're saying Weaver smells terrible.
Yeah. Just wanted to be sure.
I think that he, like, looks up and makes eye contact with you and just says, "You might want to watch what you say."
"Oi, lads, I understand that we've had a hard time, but now's not the time for swords and sworded tongues. Calm yourselves. We're a team here."
"A team?"
"Aye."
"A team would know when one of their own goes down." "With the ship. Were you not there? Did we not bring him with us?"
Are you talking about me?
Krasa is, like, pointing at Oscar. Like, "Do we not bring Oscar with us?"
"Krasa, I'm not sure what you mean."
"I'm talking about Butternut." And when he says Butternut, you can hear, like, squeaking under his coat.
"Oh, no.
Did you lose one of your rats, Krasa? Butternut."
Did I...
"Krasa, allow me to get another..."
"No? I can take the risk.
Let me, one moment. And Oscar gets up and he goes and grabs another shot glass. And he brings it over the table.
Thimble.
And it's a full shot glass. He comes over and he puts it at the table and he says, and also one for Butternut, who, though some of you may not understand this, was helpful. Butternut and the rest of the rats.
One of the bandits chuckles like...
I immediately like stifle him and be like, you shut your fucking mouth when you talk about Krisa and his rats that way.
He like covers his mouth as to like pretend to be sorry, but you can see that he's not and he still thinks it's funny.
Krisa like stands up from the table and like looks at the bandit. Okay. Krisa, I thought this was different.
Krisa, we've got your payment for the job here.
How much?
Well, it's 2 coin apiece for us.
10 coin!
Aye, and
how many times do I have to tell you?
I understand.
10 coin.
Let me go talk to Wakasis. Let me see what I can do. You know, he manages the books now, so. And Oscar, like,
and
walks.
Wakasis is standing next to the bar. He wasn't by the table.
Sure, sure.
He was sitting next to the bar.
So I walk over to Wakasis and I say, Wakasis, he did a good job. It's because of him that the ship's down now. Is there anything from the vault we can spare him? Maybe even just another coin. He doesn't deserve 10, but he, you know.
Wakasis is like, I don't know what it is with this guy. I buy drugs from him once.
All right, I understand. Krisa, I'm sorry. We haven't got the coin to spare. I can pay you what everyone else is getting for a fair share, and you've done your fair share for certain, but I simply don't have any more to offer you.
You hear like a crunch as Krisa like smashes his chair on the ground.
Yeah, it's like this. It's like this. It like takes like 30 seconds for the chair to break, and Oscar just stands there. Yeah. And very similar.
How wide is the table? Is the table wide enough that I can reach across and grab Krisa?
I don't think so. No. This is the table you guys have had meetings at. You've scheduled plans. Like, it's much larger than your arm span.
Yeah, Oscar, just like when he was getting punched by Winston, he just sort of leans on his cane and lets Krisa do his thing. Until he's done.
Krisa, like, points at the table. This isn't the last you'll hear from me. And he, like, scurries out of the front door.
Krisa, hold on. Your coin...
a rat, like, it bites the bat. Like, a couple of them pull it out after Krisa. Like, after he's it literally takes them 30 seconds to pull this bag of coin off the table and out after him.
Yeah. Oscar's just like, all right, I'm sure we'll see him again. Anyway. Thank you for coming here tonight, I guess. I shouldn't start another one. I'm sorry. My thoughts are so jumbled here. Enjoy your drinks. And he just, like, sits down really awkwardly. And he, like, grabs the... Like, I imagine, like, no one's saying anything. And he just, like, looks around and he, like, grabs the bottle in the middle of the table and just pours himself another shot and puts it back. And
can I request to have another scene if this is all we want to do with this scene?
Is everyone... I mean, are you guys done with the scene? If there's anything, we can do one last thing, but if everyone's done, then we can.
Yeah, I think that the last thing that Oscar says, so as everyone's sitting there just in silence, he just, like, the last thing we see of him is, he's just sitting there, and someone gets up, it's probably one of the bandits, someone gets up to go leave, because the meeting's over, and he says, 2 more weeks, come back in 2 more weeks, we'll get started again. And Oscar just waits there at the table until everyone else is gone. Like, he's the last person to leave.
Okay. All right, so the scene I want, Ian, is pretty much directly after we left the boat.
Yes.
I want to find some abandoned alley or some abandoned building, or I can get some time apart from anyone.
Okay.
And I kind of just walk into, let's say, just this back alleyway. And in my head, I'm still hearing that laughter in the distance in the back of my head. And I just, like, knock something off of a box. There's, like, a bottle, and I just smack it against a wall and just say, "What the hell is so goddamn funny?"
And as you say this, like, it's like one of those things where the, like, the bottle's, like, you know, it flies across the, like, off the box and hits the wall and shatters against it. And then, like, it slowly, the camera pans, and there's, like, a figure where there wasn't a figure there anymore. And the, like, upper half of him is obscured through a shadow. Like, there's light being cast off, like, a lamplight from, like, outside the alley on the lower half. But, like above his torso, like, his right arm is seen, but his left arm is completely dark, and you can't see his face. You can see, like, the silhouette. And he kind of, you can see his eyes slightly glowing a very orange tinge. The whites of his eyes are glowing, like, lightly kind of yellowish, and then, like, the actual, like, iris of his eyes is orange, and he kind of, the voice that talked, that spoke to you, after you were hit by Bear, last week when we played, and, the laughter, the voice, that voice, is, starts speaking, and he says, like, "Oh, are you angry?"
"Oh yeah, brother."
"Angry would be an understatement."
"Well, I think you'll find that anger can be used for a great deal of things if you learn to control it, much like my own. I mean, I'm a demon, but, you know, we do have our own feelings and our very own, our vices and such. I think you should learn to control that. It's not very befitting of a gentleman." And he kind of goes, like,
he just says, this, and he just, like, points and just is gesturing at himself, "that you have done to me, this is mine now, and you have no authority over it."
He kind of, he chuckles, and then his, like, the arm from the shadow kind of emerges, and you feel this, like, shuddering in your body, that I think causes you to collapse to your knees. And he, you know, he chuckles, and then it stops, and there's, like, no humor in his voice, and he says, like, "I think you'll learn that I have more authority than you think I have, Weaver."
And I just, like, stare directly into his eyes and just say, "We'll see about that," and I walk off.
Mm-hmm. And we see, like, you know, the figure watch you go. And as you, as after you've left, he kind of stands there for a bit. And he's like, "Humans are strange, aren't they?" And there's this other silhouette we may recognize, as she has black long hair and vague stars in her as it glints off her. She says, Willy. Like, "Oh yes, yeah, it's totally Willy."
He's a demon now. Yeah,
he's had a sex change and is now a demon. So
whoa.
No, so she says, "They're interesting. We can learn to use them for our good. But I would caution you to leave a certain someone alone. She's not your plaything. She's mine." And he looks at her, and you know, his eyes blink, and he kind of says, "I'll keep it in mind." And he kind of walks back into the shadow and leaves her standing there. And she kind of looks off into the sky, the completely black sky, and it flashes away. And I mean,
That's where we
should do. We be. Have. Does anyone want to do a scene, or do we want to move to XP? No,
let's move to XP and let's.
All right.
Let's go ahead and handle our downtime next session.
Nice. Yeah. All right.
That's where we'll pick up.
So, who would like? Does anyone want to go first, or should I just pick someone?
You should just go around the table.
All right. We'll start with Emily. What has Lyric done? So. Did you roll? I'm going to be asking, did you roll any desperate actions? But I mean,
yes,
yes.
I don't think I actually did this time.
You did it.
I don't think I did.
No, there's only
everyone around me did.
Yeah, in fact, only Weaver and myself made rolls this session.
That's right. That is right.
Yeah, I had the opportunity to do certain things, but those didn't pan out. So It is okay.
All right. You address the challenge with knowledge or arcane power?
I thought about it, but I didn't actually do it because okay. I was not willing to trauma.
Seems reasonable.
Yeah, there comes a point where you're like, trauma, XP, or the livelihood of my character? which should
I'm
I lean
waiting
towards?
For the perfect time
yeah.
to go.
It has to be perfect. okay. Did you express your beliefs, drives, heritage, or background?
In ways, yes. There were, of course, a couple of allusions to the wreckage of Lyric's former Leviathan hunting ship, and being on another sinking ship brought a lot of terrible memories for her. So definitely delving into her background and also heritage,
yeah.
You know, her past profession as a Leviathan hunter. And... oh gosh, what else was I going to say? There was something else. Oh, I don't know if the stuff related to like Lyric's ritual or her desire to do the ritual, if that's something related to the next thing.
Well, I think it fits in this one because it shows your desire to want to achieve that. Plus the fact that we kind of saw Lyric normally seems very held together, but you know, briefly we get glimpses of sometimes she isn't, and sometimes she doesn't necessarily jump to the task because her mind is at other places. So,
yeah,
I think there's 2 XP for that because of those different areas.
Okay.
Did you struggle with any issues from your vice or trauma?
I don't could've. Have a trauma yet. I could have. I could have struggled real hard with that. Yeah, I mean, I don't think so technically, because if we're saying that the stuff with her, like, itch to perform her ritual is related to the previous thing, then...
I don't think probably... there was a struggle there necessarily, so...
No, it was more just, you know, wailing of the damned and that kind of, you know, white noise.
Yeah. All right.
So I'm very close to advancing.
And like I just reminding everyone because we have it. I've only talked about it a couple of times, but you can take the XP points that you get from the playbook advancement stuff and put them into the insight prowess and resolve if you want to.
If you don't want to take another ability because you're like me and you haven't even used half of your abilities yet.
When you have like 5, like as Silas, I had like 6. I had a lot of abilities that I was like, they're really handy, but I only have 2 skirmish, and I'm supposed to fight people all the time. So
yeah, I have 5 of them right now, so I'm probably gonna spend a little time actually test driving those.
Okay, Oscar, you rolling in desperate.
I did, and I already marked it. I went ahead and put it in there as a resolve point. I'm hoping to increase my ability to attune to the ghost field.
Yeah! Boop, boop. Did you address the challenge with knowledge or arcane power?
I would have to say, yes, I did do that. I addressed the challenge of trying to get possessed. By saying, please do not, and also, I'm really sorry.
Please stop. All right. What do you think that's a 1 or a 2, Matt?
It's an interesting question. Because the implications, the scene itself felt like a 2 XP moment, but as far as like actual things I did, right, like that was the only ghost based thing I did. I didn't also like use the ghost field to get a hold of Krisa or something like that. So that's up to you.
Okay. I'll defer to the the description of XP stuff.
Okay.
Sometimes, you know, if it's like especially compelling and super strong, I'll, you know, I think 2 XP. Right. This is a situation where I'm both trying to, I think it's worth 2 XP, but also only one. I'll say one because sure. I feel like you will still get more XP after that specific, yes. you know, yes. trigger. Yep. Do you express your beliefs, drives, heritage, or background?
So, my drive and background, is like that I'm an investigator and that I am of a, I'm from the area. I'm an orphan from a high, you know, high class family that has abandoned me. I didn't really get to do any of that. My beliefs, like kind of, my belief okay. that like, it's okay to, like, get a hold of a guy who just died and tell him he's dead and that it's time for him to do the rest of his job.
Mm-hmm.
That's a belief that Oscar holds, that, like, there is a, you know, it's almost like a sense of duty, in a way. Duty.
It was less, like, you're going to do this because I'm a whisperer and
right,
I can tell
right,
you
right.
what to do.
Like, and that's totally within the rules. Like, I could have actually just been like, I'm compelling you to do this. Right, but that's not how Oscar works when he's like
yeah.
working with someone that he knows. He's not just going to be like, I'm going to take over your dead body and make you do stupid shit. Like, like he, yeah, there was a, you know, he had a conversation because he trusts the people that he's with.
It was more like, rather than forcing him, you were like, I know you're dead, but I think you should do this to help us because you can.
Yeah, additionally, the fact that he's going to go talk to his wife afterward is actually yeah. something that it might be part of his soft trauma, but it's also just who he is. Like, because he's an investigator and, like, he's done, like, crime work before, he's familiar with being the guy who has to go tell somebody that someone is dead. Right.
Yeah, and so. I think that totally fits into soft. And I'll say, like, another thing I noticed about the like background is, like, you even mentioned, like, please talk to Willie, like, you know.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
you tell him.
Yeah, well, definitely that should go in the background tick.
Yeah, mark so, 2 XP for that.
For the background or the vice?
The background.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have.
And then vice and trauma. So you've leveled up, so did you struggle with issues from your vice or trauma?
Yes.
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 Again. You talked about those. Do you think they're one or two? Do you think it's happened enough that you think it's a two, or is it just a one?
I think that tonight's session was a two for the trauma, because
yeah.
Oscar, pre-trauma, would not have had a meeting and stumbled over his words and, mm-hmm. you know, tried to make it a memorial, really. Like, he wouldn't have done that. He would have been like, all right, that's the risk. We know it. Let's move on. Let's go to the next one. So,
okay. Mark 2 XP. Okay. Wherever you want for that.
Wait, wherever I want?
Well, I mean, I'm just saying in the playbook or in the, you know, resolve and prowess
oh,
and
I can,
stuff. Yeah.
I can do that. Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. The
oh, yeah. See, I thought it was just the desperate XP. Could go to
no.
things. Oh, sweet, cool.
Desperate. Oh no, desperate XP.
Only is for those things.
Site, or it goes
oh, okay.
into the
first
you rolled. So cool. If you rolled resolve with desperate, or like a resolve action with desperate, yeah. like a two, you put it into resolve.
Cool. So I'm gonna put those other 2 points then into resolve. So I'm only 1 point away
right.
from getting better at that.
Yeah, you're 1 point. That's nice.
Yeah, yeah. Cool. And I'll tell you. I'll tell you how I've leveled up later on.
Yeah, yeah. Let's do Weaver. Let's do Weaver.
Yeah.
You roll any desperate actions.
3 times.
Very desperate session.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was very desperate that session.
Desperate boy.
So yeah. Very, very desperate. No, I didn't address any challenges with stealth or evasion. This wasn't the score for that.
Yeah, yeah. But did you express your beliefs, drives, or heritage or background?
I did so much of that. Are you kidding me? I think that I get 2 for that.
All right. I do 2. Between the shadowy figure in the alley and the various, the fact that you actually, like, I was surprised when you gave up chasing Goldie. I was very much ready for Weaver to just be like, I guess pull a Silas and not give up. Because I was, during the whole confrontation, I'm like, Silas would just kill everyone. He just would do it. Like, no one would live.
Oh,
but,
and his Weaver's like determination to continue to move forward throughout this encounter and just go after everyone he saw, you know, that was an expression of his drives and his heritage and all that. So
two for that.
That levels me up.
Hell yeah.
Did you struggle with any issues from your vice or trauma? You don't have trauma.
No. Oh, and didn't struggle from that.
I can say did not, so.
All they didn't show up.
So. yeah.
Well, I leveled up.
That's right, downtime, I believe.
We'll see something.
And last, well, okay, we do have our crew sheet after this, but not least, and not last, Krisa.
Last, but neither least.
This is our
This happened last time.
But neither last nor least.
Did you roll any? I believe you did not roll any desperate actions.
Didn't do any rolling sessions.
Because I was like, you're in a desperate situation.
I have exactly the skill for that.
Yeah, and I'm like, you have the skill, and you're like, I'm going to sit down and let my rats do all the work. Did you address a challenge with technical skill or destruction?
I tried.
But
no. Yeah. not this time.
Last time, yeah.
Last time, big time, this time.
Yeah, last time, if I could have given you three, I would have. But I believe you did express your beliefs, drives, heritage, or background in this session.
Yes, I think so.
I mean, the biggest one being that when we did flipped, rather than one of the contacts or the customers or clients, that we didn't mention it, but Krisa was actually the one that was flipped. And he's gone. He's gone on to some other organization, or just his rats, I guess.
The rat squads. The rat pack, even.
Oh, no.
He's gone to a better place. The sewers.
Did you struggle with... So mark two for that, and did you struggle with your vice or traumas during the session?
No. Well, my vice is weird, so maybe.
Weird, so
I struggle to make that work.
I mean, Mark, I mean, Chris is gone. He's taken off. I think he's been extra weird and very. And so before I move on to crew, I want to give one small send off for Krisa. Krisa left with his rats carrying the bag after him. I think we'll see one last glimpse of Krisa before he's gone. What is he doing, and what scene do we see Anthony as he takes off?
I think that we see sort of an overflow chamber in the sewers, dimly lit through a storm drain, and you can see the moonlight shining through. Everything is glistening, and Krisa's huddled over a big dark mass that you can't really see in the middle of this room. And you can hear him kind of murmuring to himself, you know, I gotta fix it. And he's sitting there with his rats on his shoulders. And as it moves around the room, I guess where we use the camera all the time to describe this, as the camera follows around, you know, you get a long shot around his shoulder. And he's carefully wiring a huge device. And as you pan out, you know, you can see that some of it's covered with a big piece of fabric, but you can see he's working on a timer, and it's a huge bomb.
Oh my God.
Of course.
And
big bomb.
And he snaps at one of the rats on his shoulder and sends him off, and he, you know, crawls up out of the storm drain, and then, you know, fades to black from there.
All right. Now, last and I think least, maybe, because all the characters most. Crew sheet. Let's do that.
Okay. We executed a successful thing. We finally did it.
Over three sessions.
That score That score took much longer than I would have anticipated it. You know, it was good.
You were wiping out a rival crew.
That's true. No small matter.
No.
Yeah, it was a boatload of work.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Explosive ending, though. Really just impactful, you might say.
It's really incredible how quickly we sunk the whole crew.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We sunk a lot of time into it as well.
Mm-hmm. I don't know how we're going to stay afloat after this, you know?
Yeah, I don't know, but I really like the romance between Krisa and his boats. Or, I mean, his rats, his boats.
Yeah.
I ship it.
Krisa didn't take the boat with him, did he? The crew boat?
No. He's just like sailing with boat.
The anchor to the crew.
No, he abandoned ship pretty quick, like after that. Anyways, I have the Shadow's crew sheet up now.
Okay.
Did we success? Yeah, we did. We executed. We sabotaged them two for that because it was, you know. Means we're really successful. Away from leveling up. Yep.
Nice.
We contended with challenges. One XP for that because they weren't huge. They weren't the biggest.
Right. We leveled up.
This is the point we talked about last time.
Yeah.
That I am very excited for. Did we bolster our crew's reputation or develop a new one? I think we did both.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yay.
So our reputation before was ambitious. Is there a list of potential ones, or is it just whatever?
Yes, have it right now. It's on the crew creation. There's ambitious, brutal, daring, honorable, professional, savvy, subtle, or strange.
I think brutal is a good possibility.
Yeah.
What was the third one that you mentioned?
I believe it was
after. Honorable. No, after brutal.
Daring.
Either brutal or daring would probably be good choices. What do you guys think?
I'm sorry, which page is this on?
This is on page 48.
Okay.
The crew creation. It's like right after all of the character stuff.
Oh, okay.
This is just my opinion. You guys can all decide on it, but I think it's brutal. Just because it's cementing something that has been happening for a long time, which is a lot of killing.
If only we were the assassins, we could get XP for killing.
It could also just be daring, because we sunk a ship we were on.
Yeah.
Yep.
You know, like, we've done a couple things that, like, were just bold and stupid.
Yeah.
But we succeeded, so that means they're daring.
Yeah. I'm leaning more towards daring than brutal, personally.
It sounds like, I mean, we're not the type of crew that we're like, cut them down as they run.
They're like slaughtering people.
If you get in our way, we'll mess you up. But, you know,
yeah.
We haven't really demonstrated, like, we're not the Peaky Blinders, type violence. You know?
We're not? Because I'm pretty sure.
No.
I don't think we're quite on that level yet. No, it's still some potential to grow, you know, and improve.
Yeah.
All right, so you want to take daring?
Yeah, I want to take daring. I think daring's
daring.
Good. It means someone might come to us to hire us for some sort of crazy cool job.
Yeah.
All whereas right. Brutal sounds like they'd come and be like, "I need you to murder an entire city of people." Like,
so
just do that for me.
This isn't daring necessarily like what they want you to do, but more like what they see of you.
Right.
They
like, and that's why you would hire someone, right? Because they're qualified for the job. Right. Like.
Be like, daring, hey, we need you to break into Iron Hook Prison and rescue this person, you know?
Brutal.
Like,
we need you to murder all the inmates.
Yeah.
All right.
On board.
2 XP for
that. We're not on board anymore.
And I believe you did express the goals, drives, inner conflict, or essential nature of the crew.
There was some conflict that happened.
Yeah, I'll say one. I mean...
We're expressing their goals, you know, our goal is to expand, and so by taking over this turf, you know, we're expressing that goal. So I would say 2, because we expressed that goal, and we expressed some inner conflict, you know, with the ending, and there was some just some stuff throughout the score that took place that expressed some inner conflict. So I would argue for two for that.
What will it be then?
Is it anyone going to support me on that? Or
I think we should get one. I think we should get one, honestly, because we did it. We did the job. We expressed our drive by getting that thing. We also just did the thing and got out. We didn't, like, there wasn't a moment where, like, you know, we had any big conflict. Our conflict was, like, everyone's tired and pissed because the job was tough, you know? That's normal.
And this is me thinking mechanically, but also we kind of decided that, you know, Krisa leaving would be because of Flipped, and also for a couple other reasons. So I'm not, like, I do agree that there was conflict there, but I don't think it ultimately has done something to the actual, I mean, obviously Krisa leaving is important, but I think for the most part, the crew will move on from that, and it's not going to be like a, you know, a situation where, you know, when Silas was here and Oscar and him were fighting, where they then it affected, you know, every interaction between those two.
Okay.
But I mean, it's up to you guys.
I vote one.
I'll be fun with one.
Okay. Yeah, one XP. Fine.
All right. We did level up. Again. Yeah, we did level up. We have three XP in our next level as well. So
yes.
Cool.
And I think we'll probably do the same thing as last time where we decided between sessions, and we'll come back and
absolutely. Yeah, we'll level up in the next session when we start. We'll get into it with first we'll talk about if any of us leveled up. I'll be saying what I am leveling up with. Then we'll talk about and Weaver. Lyric, did you level up?
No, okay. I went away.
So Weaver and I will be talking about our level up experience, and then the crew will level up and we'll explain what we chose there, and then we'll be heading into downtime. Get into the next pieces of our game. So cool. Let's go around and let's do some quick hooks and plugs, some shout outs. Mike, why don't you go ahead and get us started with that? And Mike here with a webcam and internet.
You can see my face this time. It's cool. And I did
get
everyone the update. Whereas last week I was a mere 0.05 upload speed, I am 0.40 upload speed this week.
That's what it is. Dude.
Significant
that
improvement.
That is an 800% improvement.
And it's still shit. But hooks and plugs. I actually have some now, which is great. Cool. I have been hanging out with the Encounter Roleplay crew over on Encounter RP on Twitch on Mondays at noon o'clock. Central Standard Time, which is me, which was 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time and 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That is on twitch.tv/EncounterRP.
Are you sure it's please Encounter RP, not Encounter Roleplay?
Pretty sure the Twitch is Encounter RP. Please double check for me.
I will do that.
If I'm shouting them out incorrectly, then I...
It's Encounter Roleplay, yeah.
On Twitch? Okay.
Yep, I got it. That is my fit.
I think that it's their Twitter that's Encounter RP.
Yeah.
So that's where I got that confused. So tune in there on Mondays. I am playing a Dragonborn Monk. We are all enslaved to Vecna, so that's pretty cool. So
and you're playing D&D 5th edition, right? It's like a beginner's campaign.
That's correct. Yeah, it's D&D 5th edition. Yeah, like Matt said, it's a couple other people playing have never played D&D before, let alone on a stream. So it's kind of like walking them through that. And this is my first time playing 5th edition. I've only played 3.5 before, so I am not entirely unfamiliar with D&D. But
so it's better.
The monk is powerful.
5th edition is...
Matt's not too happy. Not too happy about what 5th edition did to the ranger.
No. Actually, they fixed the ranger. Now it's actually super sweet.
Okay.
Yeah.
With the improved ranger?
Yes. It's super good. It's very cool.
In addition to that, I always try to shout out John Harper, the creator of this fine game that we're playing, Blades in the Dark. Please follow him on Twitter and go give him your money to purchase this game. And...
Yeah.
According to what I read on the internet, the rumors that I hear, the final PDF version of Blades in the Dark will be released on January 30th this year. So, like, before we play next time, we will have...
So next time we play, whenever that is,
next time we play, we will have the final version of the rules if this rumor is true. So I look forward to that. If you don't own this game yet, then I think that is an excellent time to get it. So if you're looking to get it, wait until then just to make sure that you get the final version. Yeah. It's going to be Evil Hat Productions. So give them your money, and you'll also be able to start getting pre-orders for the physical copies if you weren't able to get on the Kickstarter like me and Ian. I'm going to pre-order that as soon as I have the money to. I'm looking forward to checking out the final version of the rules. I think this game is great, and John definitely deserves your support and your money. So please go do that.
Awesome. Thank you, Michael. Ian, how about you?
Hi, I'm Ian, GM here. You can follow me on Twitter at My Last Swan Song. I haven't been too... into that lately, kind of taking minor breaks from Twitter right now. However, I mean, I've been watching a couple shows, playing a couple games. I was just playing The Behemoth, who made Castle Crashers and Battle Block Theater, two great games. They have the early access for their newest game called Pit People, which is like a strategy game, where the majority of the voice acting in that game is by Stamper. So if you go to Stamper TV, I believe it is on YouTube. He's an animator, voice actor. He's so good in Pit People. It's hilarious to have all of these different characters voiced by him. He also did the narrator for Battle Block Theater. So he's great. I love that game. So much fun. Just the RNG that you have, and it's not fully out yet. They'll be fleshing it out more and more, but I got that, and I'm looking forward to seeing how that goes. I've also been watching X-Files, enjoying that. infuriated by Scully, but I mean, who really isn't that has watched that show? I mean, how can you?
She's perfect.
How can one episode you see a ghost, acknowledge said ghost, and then the next episode not admit that there is a possibility for AI that could kill people?
Alternative facts.
Yes, exactly.
No!
Sorry.
Anyways,
that show's cool.
Yeah. Other than that, I mean, you can follow me on Twitter. I'm working on some art. I was actually drawing art today as I watched some streams of Resident Evil 7, which if you haven't, I would suggest finding. I mean, unless you want to wait to play it, that's cool too, but that game looks pretty wicked in lots of different ways. Yeah, sweet wicked. Yeah, it's wicked. Coining that term. Yeah, that's it for me.
Awesome. Emily, what do you... Oh. Emily, you look like Anthony right now.
Oh.
And Anthony's Anthony, too. Emily, uh-oh. Something's gone terribly wrong.
I mean right!
I mean terribly right. One moment while I make a quick change here. That is the strangest thing.
I see it now.
And let me just... All right, yeah, that's normal. Everything's fine.
Oh, that...
Go ahead.
That's wonderful. I was prepared to walk a mile in Anthony's shoes, but I guess it won't have to happen. But anyway, in the way of shout outs, I don't have a ton this week. I will say that I will be making stuff on YouTube again, hopefully before the month is out. This has probably been the longest break that I've taken from uploading content in a while, and it kind of happens that way around the holidays, especially since I generally do a lot of TV shows, and most things are on hiatus right now. And those things that I have been binge watching or watching when I get the chance, I have to write scripts for. So, and Mighty Sophia is my channel. I'm going to be reviewing a number of shows like Twin Peaks before the new series returns. I will be doing a review of the final seasons of Penny Dreadful, hopefully soon. yes, that will come. I will talk to you more about that, I promise, Ian. And Bates Motel, actually, its fifth and final season is coming right around the corner. Better Call Saul, stuff like that. So, YouTube channel, I'm Mighty Sophia. That's also my Twitter handle. Those are kind of my main hubs right now. But
you should make sure to check out Taboo on FX with Tom Hardy.
Ah,
I've been wanting to check that one out.
Yeah.
Cool. Anything else, Em?
I think that's it for now.
Okay. Anthony, talk to us. Why don't you give us a shout out and tell us what's up for Anthony in the future?
Well, Anthony, you should follow him on Twitter.
You should.
The link is on...
It's under your face.
It's here.
It's down.
If you want to see, lots and lots of like frog pictures and memes, then Anthony is the guy to follow for memes.
There are... occasionally that those are featured on the Twitter page. I cannot promise how often, but if you need the frog pick, I can send it to you directly. I can DM
Anthony, the frog we pick. Will always need the frog pick.
It's true.
That's good. I am also going to be stepping away from the show for a while. I have a lot of other things that I need to do for the time being, and the time slot's not going to work for my schedule. But I am hoping to appear in some more Friendly Fire TV content of perhaps another sort, other role-playing games, who knows, whatever else we get up to on here. Of course, play a few other games. Actually, it's just this. This is the only game I've ever played in my life. But Matt and I play Magic together and a few other games, and I'm looking forward to seeing what's next on the channel, and I'm hoping perhaps I can encourage that to actually exist in the near future. So that's it.
Thank you, Anthony. As for myself, my name is Matt, and this is what I do. I am the dude who makes Friendly Fire TV happen. Before I give my plugs about Friendly Fire TV and where you can find all the stuff we do, I wanted to give a couple shout-outs to some content creators that exist that I was just thinking about before we got on the show. One, if you're into art for Magic the Gathering or proxies for Magic the Gathering, proxies being fake cards that are just alternate art, sometimes alternate art, sometimes not. There's a guy on Twitter, his handle is @theproxyguy. His work is just incredible. I just found him last week, and he's been doing a whole project called The Cube Redo, where he's redoing a bunch of cards that would go into a cube, and it's just incredible. Awesome work. Go give him a follow if you're interested in Magic stuff or custom cards. Additionally, go to Twitter and find Jeremy Newell. That's @JeremyNoell. He's one of the community content creators for StarCityGames.com, and he's been doing a really awesome show called Split Second, which is sort of like a Magic the Gathering news thing. He just very recently got involved with doing a lot of stuff online related to promoting Magic content, and it's just really awesome. He's done a great job of what he's doing, and if you're interested in Magic or you know of Magic and you want to know like where else you can go, he is a great first starting point because he tells all about all the other community creators there. The only other thing I wanted to shout out was Roll20 and D&D for finally partnering and getting the monster manual onto Roll20. It is a little bit expensive, but I think I'm going to get it because I run a 5th edition campaign on Roll20, and being able to just plop monsters into the campaign at will and just have all their stats all there together is just like, are you kidding me? That's a dream. Like, most of my prep time is me setting up the things in Roll20, so the fact that that's a thing now that I can just do is pretty awesome and probably worth the investment. So just shout out to that, and that it's a thing that they can do, and that the people at Wizards are saying, hey, instead of like making a competing digital project for I almost said World of Warcraft, D&D, the other game, like they're really using using what they have with the system that we use on this show as well, Roll20. So just really excited about the future of that and just the future of playing tabletop games with your friends online. So with all that being said, back to this. You can follow me and my Twitter's right there. You can also follow us on Twitter. Our handle is at FriendlyFireTV, and anytime we go live or post a video, we'll be posting the VODs for this coming up very soon, probably Thursday and Friday of this week. It's currently Tuesday. You can find out that it's there. Anytime we do like a random live stream, I've been streaming some Magic the Gathering online recently. You can follow us there. And our handle is not at POTUS, unfortunately, although that's what Anthony's putting in the chat right now. Additionally, you can follow us, or not follow us, you can subscribe to us on YouTube to check out all the VODs. We upload every single episode that we do for our Roll20 show for Blades in the Dark, and occasional other videos as well. I don't upload all the streams for Magic Online because playing music sometimes and whatnot, but yeah, we'll have some more content coming up. We're hopefully going to be looking into ways to expand what we can do with Anthony and just in general, so... Yeah. I know we went a little bit over tonight, but thank you guys for watching. I appreciate you all being here and hanging out. Thanks for coming if you are watching the Blades series as well, the Roleplay Blades series. Thanks for being here. If you're watching it and you're watching the VODs for this, thank you for watching this. Glad to have you. I'm glad to be carrying you along for this adventure. So anyway, thank you. Have a good night.